So we begin then today with the two presentations which we had planned for this session. We shall have two of the presentations that were adjudged the best in the among the presentations of the course. The first presentation today shall be by Lakshmikant Vyas and Hari Suman on the theme of predator-prey relationships modeled in a signals and systems context. I leave it to them to explain to you the details and the model that they have built, and I also exhort you to look carefully at the model that they have come up with and the comparisons that they have made with some actual data that they have. The second presentation would be by Shakti Prakash Chittara and Vikramjit Walia on the spectral behavior and the whole scheme of one method of digital modulation and demodulation named binary phase shift keying. They shall explain to you the principle behind binary phase shift keying. They will also demonstrate to you certain typical waveforms, and they shall show you the spectral behavior of binary phase shift keying, which is abbreviated as BPSK. I now invite the first presenters, Lakshmikant and Hari, to make their presentation.
Hello friends, now we start with our presentation on the basic signals and systems in our everyday life. We have chosen our system to be a predator-prey system, and we move on to show how the concepts of signals and systems we have studied so far can be utilized to study some basic models in our everyday life. We move on to present ourselves First of all, we introduce you towards what is the predator-prey system we are basically analyzing. Further, we move to how we have constructed the model, how we have formulated the equations and the assumptions and the basic models we have considered. We further use the basic concepts of signals and systems to analyze the system, and we have then moved on to conceptualize our results and the conclusions we have drawn from this. Now, basically, what is the predator-prey system? The model we have considered assumes that there are only two species, each of being a predator and a prey. Predator is the species which hunts on the prey and survives on the prey, whereas the prey is a species which has its food supply from the nature and it's hunted by the predator. Such pairs are existing throughout the nature, like foxes, rabbits, or cats and mice. Now, to constrain ourselves to a very simple model, we have taken some basic assumptions. A few being, first of all, we have considered this to be a two species model. That is, there is a species of predator and one species of the prey. Also, the second assumption is the prey species has an unlimited food supply. That is, the prey species does not fear any death from the food supply it is getting. Then the third assumption is that there is no threat to the prey other than the specific predator I've just mentioned. The predator species is totally dependent on a single prey species as its only food supply. This is to analyze as a one-to-one system, so as there are no more species providing the predator, so as we can analyze the predator and the prey under assumptions. Now, moving on to construct the model, we have looked on to on the model as a discrete time system. Because in nature also, as we analyze the system, it is basically a discrete time system. As we analyze the predator and the prey population as discrete variables in time, say once in a month or once a fortnight, the predator population is being taken as an input for the system we have constructed, and it's denoted by x of n, whereas the prey population is denoted by y of n and is the output. Now, this model we have constructed on the basis of a real life model of heron lynx. The model we found was it had major assumptions we have taken, they were all being considered in the heron lynx model, and it was in accordance with that. So, giving you a more real life picture of how it is, we have one prey and a predator, and this will give you a more real life picture of how the model is working. Now, coming to the basic system equations. First of all, we have tried to analyze the prey equations. Prey being denoted by y of n, first of all considering as a basic assumption that if there were no predators, then the prey would be exponentially increasing with depending on the birth rate and the death rate. The constant being 1 plus birth rate minus death rate, as we can see. But also when there is some predator, then the prey population does not increase exponentially, but it also depends on the rate of hunting. And the rate of hunting can be qualified as reaching to a maximum limit, capital M, say the lynx present in the system catches a maximum of 5 hares in a day, then M goes to be capital 2 goes to be 5, and also the rate of hunting is exponentially varying with the prey population itself, because the greater is the number of prey population, the greater will be the rate of hunting. Also, the constant K mentioned over there depends on the ease with which the prey can be caught by the predators. Now, taking the two cases together, that is without predator and with the predator, we come to the final equation mentioned over here. Now, also this system has feedback in the input. The predator as input, we have, if there were no prey, then the predators would be exponentially decaying among themselves, because the prey supplies the food energy for the growth required. So, x of n plus 1 is equal to x of n into 1 minus death rate, where x is the prey population at a given time. It depends on the previous prey population into the constant, which is less than 1. But also, since the energy to support the growth is proportional to the prey hunted, hence the predator population increases with the prey amount of prey hunted. So, we reach the equation for the prey as can be seen. Now, the system is causal, it's time invariant, as it depends only on linear values of n and does not depend on any future values, hence it's causal. It has memory, as it depends on the previous values of the predator population and the prey population, but since there is an exponential term coming, and hence it's a non-linear system. Now, for analyzing the system, we have split it into 3 mutually exhaustive cases, because the system equations we have reached are non-linear, and hence it's not easy to analyze them. So, as a basic first case assumption, we have taken if the predator population is small and the prey population is large, then using the equations we have obtained the equations for this assumption, that is y, that is the prey population, is exponentially varying with the previous prey population, and also the predator population is varying with the previous prey predator population, and the constants k1 and k3 plus am both are greater than 1. This shows that they are increasing with time, and also we can analyze it in system that the red one, the predator population which is on the prey population which is on the top, is increasing with time, because initially the predator population is very small, and hence it's independent of the predator population and it is increasing. Also, the predator is able to catch as much prey as it can freely. So, the predator is also increasing. This was a graph we plotted for the first assumption in MATLAB. Now, going to the second case assumptions, that is, we have the pre-population to be large and the predator population to be comparable. Now, this case comes out as from the first case results, that is, the first case ended up into the prey population was although large, but the predator population was also reaching towards the prey population slightly. So the prey population is trying to catch hold of the predator population and trying to curb it. Now, under the given assumptions of prey population is large and predator population comparable, we formulate the other two equations, as we can see, y of n plus 1 equation and the x of n plus 1 equation. Now, when we wrote these equations, now we have come to a conclusion that these are very important equations, as they are LCCDEs. They are linear constant time, they are constant coefficient difference equations. So these can be further analyzed into the system, and as we can see, these are LSI and causal, since it does not depend on the future, and this has memory as it depends on the previous populations of the prey and the predator. Now, as we look at the middle of the graph, we have the results from the previous assumption, that is, the predator population was large and the predator population was small and the prey population was large. Now, this leads into the second case, that is, the prey population is increasing, but as the predator population increases, then the predator population tries to curb the prey population, and at a given time when the number of predators increase to some value, the prey population starts decaying because they are more hunted by the prey. And now this leads to the other case, as we may see. And now, this being LSI, we analyze the system deeply, going into the signals and systems analysis concepts, as we can see. And now I'll hand it over to Suman for analyze it further.
The system equation which we had derived earlier as was LCCDE, and it was recursive, and so being recursive, we have actually written the equation explicitly in terms of the previous values of the input, and the input equation, which is feedback, has been found to be an exponentially increasing equation for this case. And now, being an LSI system, and we can also calculate its impulse response giving an impulse input, and that has been calculated as shown. The physical significance of this would be that one particular prey is introduced into the system at zero time, and this would actually cause the prey population to decrease at that particular moment, and then afterwards continue to increase with a lesser slope or with an approximately equal slope. That's the graph of the impulse response. And now, after having calculated the impulse response, we can also calculate its Z transform. And this Z transform actually converges only for a special case, being beta is equal to alpha y at 0. And this would actually imply that the impulse response is zero in the right half plane, and that would make the system bounded, as mod z is less than k 1, which is a constant greater than 1, and this would mean that this case the system is stable. Okay, now we move on to the third case, in which the prey population isn't increasing as much as it used to increase. It has decreased, and the predator population has increased so much that it is significantly modifying the prey population. And now in the original equation, we had an exponential term, in which has been now approximated to a linear form, and these are the new equations which have been got right now, and this actually are the Lotka-Volterra model, which have been studied widely. But as you can see, that the system is non-linear, its causal shift invariant and it has memory. But being nonlinear, if most of the analysis which has been done before for the previous case cannot be done for this case. And the graph drawn using MATLAB for this case shows a kind of periodic movement of the population of predator and prey. What actually happens is, as you can see, the prey population has stopped increasing exponentially, which is what happened in the previous case, and it has started decreasing. And once it's still high, and that would mean that the predator population has also caught up with it. And then now, once the predator population has caught up with the prey population slowly starts to decrease. And once it decreases and has come to a low enough value that the predator doesn't get any food to eat, the predator population also dies down, because that's how our equation has been evolved. It's on the basis of how much energy it gets, and that depends on the population of the prey. And so once the population of prey has decreased, the predator population is also falling down, and once the predator population falls down, the prey once again rises up, as there is no predator to hunt it. And it goes back to the first case which he had assumed before. And thus, by combining all these three cases, which we have taken by simplifying the values of the population, we can see that this is approximately periodic. A kind of a rough periodic waveform is being formed for the predator and the prey population. And now if we plot the predator versus prey, and we would find a circular loop indicating the periodicity of this function. It could also be spiral, because the values actually attained are not exactly the same every time in each period. So the structure is approximately periodic, but what actually could happen in this graph is to get a spiral form for the predator versus prey model. This is the idealized net waveform which we get, which is formed when combining all the three waveforms which I got previously. And now this is a realized statistic taken of the Hare-Lynx model which was shown previously. And the Hare-Lynx model, which has been measured for around 90 years, you can see that the prey population of the hare, as it increases, the predator population catches up with the prey population, and this has caused it to decrease, and the predator population has also simultaneously decreased with this. And like, there is a little bit of time gap, and it has formed a roughly periodic function, and this confirms with our equation which we have calculated and which I have drawn plotted. Okay, now further analysis, like what we had seen is a two species model in which there was one prey, one predator. But then there are more complex systems. We are taking a food chain in which there is a whole series of predator and prey, and each species in between is affected by the predator on top of it and the prey below it. And this would imply that, like, suppose we have a system in which the input is the predator population above the species, and another input being the prey population below the species, and the output being the population of that particular species. And now as you can see, the system equation for this is actually a more generalized case of the original predator prey system which we have taken into consideration. Now the inputs are z and y, the inputs are z and x, and the outputs being y. And now suppose we take producers. Producers are in the bottom part of this food chain, and it has infinite food supply. That would mean that the second term in this equation, that is actually showing the growth with respect to the food supply it gets, it actually turns out to be the growth rate into the population of y. Which is what we had for the prey population in the original case. Thus, you can see that this equation reduces to the prey equation for the first case. And now if we take y to be the tertiary consumers, there is no creature which can hunt y, and that would mean that x is zero. And x being zero, we have that this equation simplifies to the predator equation, which was the input equation with feedback, which we had originally kept for the two species model, and thus we have a generalized equation for the whole of the food chain in this predator species model, and that ends our course presentation. Thanks.
So we thank both Lakshmikant and Hari Suman for an excellent presentation on predator prey systems. It's interesting to know how a biological system could be modeled or could be approximated by difference equations as they did. Now, first let me invite questions from the class. If the class doesn't have questions, I have some questions for the class. What were the assumptions under which the model became linear? The model was initially non-linear. What was it that made it non-linear? And if, you know, once it became linear, what was it that made it linear? What was the approximation needed to make the system linear? Yeah, give him the mic. Is that correct? Is that, would you like to add or correct that? So Samir says that the situation under which it became linear was that the hare population or the prey population was very large. Would you like to make a correction in that, or would you like to modify the answer? Give him the mic. Come here. Would you like to add to that answer?
So you have the prey population.
So you speak into the mic.
The prey population is large enough for the predator to not actually affect it at that moment. The predator keeps rising exponentially because it has enough prey available. So that's correct.
Okay. Has that inspired you to ask some further questions? If not, I have another question. In that case, what do you think the system behavior would be if you don't make this assumption? You've seen their presentation, you've seen a certain system behavior, right? With the approximations of linearity, right? So they solved the corresponding LCD and came up with certain approximations. Now what do you think would happen if the system were not approximated by a linear model? Of course, then the Z transform would not be applicable. So one might have to, I agree, you don't have the tools and techniques with you at the moment to solve such a system, but would you like to venture a guess? So would you like to try and modify the slightly a question, thought-provoking question? No responses on that. Please. So Devendra has an answer. Let's listen to him. Now speak clearly. Very good. Yes. So, what do you think the effect would be on the behavior of the system or output?
It will predator concentration increase, but it will get up to some time, because then prey concentration will decrease, like their periodic model. So, for some time, like time constant, it will increase.
would the presenters like to comment on that? Come here.
Actually, the basic assumptions we have taken are only to analyze a system as a simple case. But the system continues to behave the way it is, that is, the predator population keeps on changing as periodic with the prey population, and the predator spikes, that is, the maxima of the predator population, are shifted by a little amount from the prey population, that is, after achievement of the prey population maximum, the predator population would be achieved after some time delay. The system continues to behave in the same way.
Okay, good. So then I think with that set of questions, I must invite the class to think further on the model that has been proposed and to modify it if possible. Yeah. Now I invite the next, you know, students who are going to make a presentation. We shall now have a presentation. We shall now have a presentation on a method of digital modulation and demodulation named binary phase shift keying. Now, I will just say a line or two about binary phase shift keying. It is a method of modulation or demodulation where one transmits a sequence of bits with the two bits represented with two different phases of a carrier. Vikramjeet and Shakti would now explain to you in greater detail the method of modulation and demodulation and tell you a little bit about its behavior, both in the time and the frequency domains. So, I now invite Vikramjeet and Shakti to make their presentation. Come.
Yes, sir. Hello everybody, I am going to tell you about the course presentation which I did as a part of the signals and system course. It is on BPSK modulation. Now this course presentation basically BPSK is a form of modulation, and first of all we shall examine briefly why modulation is actually required. Now we need modulation for a lot of reasons. One of the reasons is efficient transmission and overcoming the hardware limitations. Now, one of the thing which has to be taken into consideration is that the antenna size is of the order of wavelength. So, the normal signals like what we speak, it is in the range of about 0 to 3 kilohertz. Now, at that frequency, the wavelength becomes immensely large and the antenna size grows proportionately. It grows very large in size and we can't have that much of an antenna size. So, what we do is that we use a carrier with a very high frequency, somewhere of the order of gigahertz. And then using that carrier of that very high frequency and changing the characteristics of that carrier in accordance with the information signal, we transmit it and henceforth reduce the antenna size. The second thing which has to, like second major advantage of modulation is, well, another one is the reducing the noise and interference. We reduce the noise and interference using modulation. Now, there are very small signals which have very small frequencies. And basically, we have that diffraction is proportional to lambda raised to power 4. Once again, the same concept, very low frequency, we have very high lambdas, very large diffraction of the signal, we are losing information. So basically, if we increase the frequencies and decrease the wavelength, the diffraction decreases and henceforth we reduce noise and interference. The third thing, the third major advantage of modulation is frequency assignment. we can transmit large amount of information at different frequencies in a bandwidth by modulating the information signal. Then the fourth advantage which we have is multiplexing. Like there are two main techniques used, CDMA and TDMA, time division multiple access and code division multiple access. We transmit a large amount of data at different frequencies. And then there is another technique in which we can transmit the large amount of data at the same frequency using different codes known as CDMA. Now in this technique, since we are transmitting each data signal with different codes, we can easily at the demodulator end decide which signal was sent by whom and henceforth transmit data. All these things wouldn't have been possible without modulation. So modulation is very important. Now I would like to discuss one of the most easiest and the best forms of, I should not say best, but one of the most easiest and which forms the basis for understanding higher forms of modulation, BPSK. Now basically BPSK is a part of phase shift keying. In phase shift keying, what we have is that different signals are transmitted and phase of each of the signals are varied in accordance with the information signal. Another technique which we have is frequency shift keying. Here the frequency of the carrier is varied in accordance with the information signal. Another one we have amplitude shift keying. Here the amplitude of the carrier is varied in accordance with the information signal. And another one is quadrature amplitude modulation. In this we vary both the amplitude and the phase of the signal. I'll tell you about this briefly later. Now BPSK. In binary we have two symbols, 0 and 1. BPSK uses signal S1 of T to represent 1 and S2 of T to represent 0. Where S1 of T, as you can see, is defined as under root of 2 EB by TB, cos of 2 pi FCT. And S2T is the same signal with the same frequency and the amplitude displaced in phase by pi radians. Therefore, minus under root of 2 EB by TB cos of 2 pi FCT. Now here, as you can observe, there is only one basis function. Under root of 2 by TB cos 2 pi FCT with unit energy. Under root 2 by TB is the normalization function. Now the message point 1, which was corresponding to the signal 1, travels in space located at point under root of EB. This can be worked out by Gram-Schmidt's orthogonalizational procedure and is a very long procedure, which I shall not tell you about right now, but which you can take from me as granted. And the message point 2, which corresponds to signal 2, is located at minus under root of EB. Now these two messages are traveling in space in a one-dimensional view, which has a signal space constellation whose diagram can be shown as the one shown in the transparency. Then region Z1, there is a message point 1 corresponding to under root of EB, and then region Z2, there is a message point 2 located at minus under root of EB. As you can see the signal space constellation for the BPSK diagram. Now there is an error density which is possible. Now what can happen is that the signal 1, which was corresponding to 1, binary 1 while being transmitted, and S1T located at under root of EB, can be distorted by noise. And if this is distorted by noise or by interference, it can be attenuated and it can cross the decision boundary and come to lie in region Z2. Now if it comes to lie in region Z2, then it basically begins to represent 0, while earlier it should have represented 1. Similarly, the message point 2 corresponding to minus under root of EB can cross the decision boundary and come to lie in region Z1. These are two cases when an error can be induced. The error density is a function of under root of EB by N0. It is actually equal to Q of under root of EB by N0, where Q of X can be defined as e raised to power minus X squared dx integrated from X to infinity. So the bit error density or the bit error rate decreases as EB increases. Now this is also apparent from the diagram which I showed you a bit earlier. As I showed you, the message points are located at under root of EB and minus under root of EB. Supposedly I increase EB, the message points are moving further away on the axis. Henceforth they are moving away from the decision boundary. So the bit error rate is decreasing. Now the another thing is, basically then if we want to transmit the same signal, then and if we want to reduce the error, then we can transmit it at larger energies. That is, we can reduce the error rate at the expense of using more power. Then another thing to be taken into consideration is the information rate. Information rate is defined as bits per second, number of bits transmitted per second. Now bit rate is symbol rate into the number of bits transmitted per symbol. I'll explain to you what a symbol is. Symbol can be actually defined as a combination of bits. For example, in BPSK, we are transmitting only two bits, 0 or 1. Here a symbol can be 0 or 1. In the form of modulation, which I'll discuss later, QPSK, we are transmitting two bits per symbol. So the possible states are 00, 01, 10 and 11. Henceforth, there the bit symbol consists of two bits. Now, as I come back to the point, the bit rate is defined as symbol rate into the number of bits transmitted per second. And information is dependent on the symbol. Information is dependent on the bits rate. Another thing to be taken into consideration is that the bandwidth required depends upon the symbol rate. Now, as we go to higher forms of modulation, the number of bits transmitted per symbol increase. So the symbol rate decreases. And henceforth, the bandwidth required decreases. This is what I'll discuss in detail later as well. Now, I shall ask Shakti Prakash, one of my colleagues, to come forward and tell you how we fabricated the BPSK waveform and how we fabricated the BPSK modulation in lab. We did it in lab, but we are not right now able to show you because of some problem in our apparatus and all. He'll explain to you on the breadboard, on the whiteboard, what exactly we did and how we proceeded.
Hello. Hello. As my colleague Bikramjit Walia has already explained you what is BPSK is all about, we have fabricated the BPSK model in lab. I will show you the circuit. The circuit consists of a 5-hour timer. Actually, in everyday life, we have input of digital input in the form of combinations of zeros and ones. In lab, we have used a 5-hour timer to provide a input of 0 and 1 in a form of square wave. A 5-hour timer, when used in a stable mode, gives a input in a form of square wave. So we have used a 5-hour timer, which gives a square input. Then another, we have a signal generator through which we have provided a sine wave of a particular frequency, let's say fc. Signal is then passed on to the inverting op amp. It effectively changes the phase of sine wave by pi radians, that is, it inverts the sine wave. That is, the output of the signal will be an inverted sine wave as compared to this original one. When these two sine wave, that is the original one and the other inverted one by pi radians, is passed on to an analog multiplexer, it's same as original. It's same as digital multiplexer, but in this we can have input signals as analog ones. Like this, we have given an input to the input to it as a signal and sine signal and another the inverted sine signal. On the basis of this input 0 and 1, either the analog multiplexer will pass the sine signal or the inverted sine signal. Let's say we have the input at 0, as 0, then the inverted signal will be passed, and when we have input as 1, the original sine signal will pass. Therefore, we have the output as, whenever there is a 0, we have one particular sine wave, and whenever there is a transition from 0 to 1, we have sine wave changed by change the phase by pi radians. So that we have done, that is the modulator signal. Now this modulator signal, the Fourier transform of this modulator signal consists of a sum of two sync functions. One has low bet fc and one another has a low bet minus fc. It's like this. Actually, we have done in the lab, we could have verified this, that the low bet comes at fc, but right now we are not able to show it. That's what is done. Actually. Now I will invite Bikramjit Walia to show the further modulation and the generalization of this BPSK in the higher forms of modulation.
As my colleague Shakti Prakash right now pointed out to you, what we did in the lab, he told you and explained it to you. Now the output which we got was in this form. We took a sine wave, we took this combination of zeros and ones. Then we basically, zero, we are transmitting of this sine wave. Now at one, the phase changed by pi radians and we were actually transmitting this. We were able to demonstrate this in the lab. However, because of the problems in apparatus, we are not able to show it to you right now. Then after that, I would like to generalize this PPSK scheme. There is an Emery PSK. Let's say here the phase of the carrier takes one of the m possible values, where theta is defined as 2 into I minus 1 pi by m. As in the case of, like, I can be defined from 1 to m. Now for Emery PSK, we have m values of theta, corresponding to m different signals located in space. Now these signals are defined as S1 of t is equal to under root of 2 by e by t into cos of 2 pi fct plus 2 pi by m into I minus 1, where I can vary from 1 to m. These are m signals in space. Here we have two basis function defined as under root of 2 by t cos of 2 pi fct and under root of 2 by t sine of 2 pi fct. Now the signal space diagram for this is two dimensional in nature, which you can see, and here we have 8 points located in space for an octaphase shift keying. These points are all displaced from each other by, like, all consecutive points are displaced from each other by a phase of pi by 4, and they all lie on a circle because this is a constant amplitude modulation scheme. Then now what we observe is that the decision boundary between the two is located at, like, it's basically the distance between the angle between the two is pi by 4, and henceforth the decision boundary lies midway between the two at the perpendicular bisector of the two message points. Now, as we can see, the message points are getting closer in space. Now, since they are getting closer in space, they can easily cross the transition boundary and henceforth begin to represent some other signal which they should not have represented earlier while they were being transmitted. Now, this induces an error. And as we can see from this diagram, since the message points are getting closer, the bit error rate is now getting higher. This is one of the disadvantages of higher forms of modulation. The bit error rate keeps on increasing. As we go from 8 to 16 to 32 to 64 to 128 and so on, the bit error rate increases a lot. Then there is an advantage as well. One of the major advantages which we have is in the information rate. Now, as discussed earlier, information rate was actually the given by bits per second, and bits per second was actually given as symbol rate into the number of bits transmitted per symbol. Now the information rate is increasing in QPSK, in 8 PSK, in 16 PSK, because the number of states and henceforth the number of bits are increasing. In QPSK we have 3 bits transmitted per symbol. In 16 PSK we have 4 bits transmitted per symbol. The entropy is increasing and henceforth the bit rate is increasing, so the information rate is increasing. Another way to look at this is the symbol rate is decreasing and henceforth the bandwidth required for the transmission of same signal is decreasing. So we require less bandwidth to transmit the same signal, and at the same time we have higher bit error rate. So this is like a comparison between BPSK and higher forms of modulation employed. Then the average power transmitted increases with increase in value of m, because if we increase the average power, the message points lie far away. The circle, the amplitude of the circle increases, and henceforth the bit error rate decreases. At the same time, as discussed, bit error rate increases with increase in value of m. Now another form of modulation is QAM. This is known as quadrature amplitude modulation. Here the amplitude and the phase of the signal are both varied. The signal constellation for Emery QAM consists of a square lattice of message points. Now one of the advantages is that the bit error rate is less than that of the Emery PSK techniques, although the information rate is same. Now, as you can see, the signal space lattice for Emery QAM, where m is equal to 16, is shown in picture. It is a two-dimensional lattice, and here the amplitude and the phase are both being varied. And another comparison between the two techniques shows you Emery PSK and Emery QAM for m is equal to 16. Here, if we work out, we shall realize that the message points in the case of Emery QAM lie further away as compared to the message points in the case of Emery PSK, and henceforth the bit error rate decreases. Now we had look at different forms of modulation. We have discussed PPSK. We have discussed higher forms of modulation in the form of Emery PSK, and also had a look at quadrature amplitude modulation, where both the amplitude and the phase is changing. Now to conclude, I would like to tell you that BPSK is the simplest amongst them all, and it really forms the basis for understanding complex forms of modulation. That is.
So we've indeed had a very illuminative presentation on one very well-known method of digital modulation and demodulation, namely the binary phase shift keying method. I now invite questions from the audience. This time I hope there are questions, which shouldn't make it necessary for me to probe a few. Yes, pass the mic. Amit has a question. Let me ask Shakti and Vikramji to try and answer the question first. If not, I'll put in some.
Depends on the symbol rate. If we decrease the symbol rate, the bandwidth required decreases. Now, as you can like modify this relation in some form, symbol rate is bit rate divided by the number of bits transmitted per symbol. As you are going to an Emery PSK from a PPSK, the number of bits transmitted per symbol are increasing. Henceforth, the symbol rate is decreasing. And since the symbol rate is decreasing, the bandwidth required decreases. That is what.
Okay, I'll add a little bit to that. You see, the idea is like this. What is very important is to understand the compromise between various resources that are available to the communication system. One resource is bandwidth. Okay, bandwidth refers to the part of the frequency axis in which most of the energy of the waveform lies. I have told you once before that it is normally impossible to contain all the energy into a part of the frequency axis for time limited waveforms, but one can confine most of the energy. So it could be 98% or 97%, and one can work out a frequency range over which most of the energy lies. Now this range is inversely proportional to the time over which a waveform is transmitted. So you see, if you transmit that sine wave over a longer time, the energy is contained in a smaller part of the frequency axis. All right? In fact, even with our knowledge of signal system analysis, we can come to this conclusion at least approximately. What would be the spectrum of a BPSK waveform? It would be the spectrum of a sine wave multiplied by a rectangular pulse. Is that right? What is the spectrum of a sine wave? A pair of impulses located at the sine wave frequencies, plus and minus fc. And what is the spectrum of a rectangular pulse? A sine x by x pattern. If the carrier frequency is large, that means if the sine wave frequency is large, then we have two sine x by x patterns concentrated around the carrier frequency. That's the nature of the BPSK spectrum if the carrier frequency is large. Can you see that? Right? So the idea is that if the carrier frequency is large, then we have a spectrum that would look roughly like this, not exactly, but roughly like this. This is, of course, this assumes that the carrier frequency is very large. If it is not, then this gets significantly modified, right? That must be kept in mind. Now, this spacing between the nulls of the spectrum is proportional to 1 by the interval. Where t is the interval of the sine wave, all right, it's proportional to 1 by t. And therefore, the larger the interval, the smaller the spacing, and it is a certain number of these lobes, the main lobe and the side lobe, that we require to cover 98% of the energy. So, you know, for example, you could decide that you will consider the first 5 lobes or the first 10 lobes. Right, depending on the amount of energy that you wish to contain. And this number of lobes is only a function of the percentage. Right? And for the same number of lobes, you occupy a smaller portion of the frequency axis if the time is larger. Now, the relation between bits and symbols is as follows. If you can communicate more bits, right, with the same sine wave, that means if you have more phases with higher forms of phase shift keying, and therefore you communicate more bits, you can give them more time, or you can increase the bit rate, either way. You know, so you could either say you will increase the bit rate and then you will have more bit rate but with the same behavior, right, or spectral behavior, or you could say that you will, you know, convey the same number of bits in the same amount of time, but you will do it in a more spectrally efficient way. In that case, what is the disadvantage? Why not keep on increasing the number of bits that you communicate per symbol or that you communicate in a phase? Let me pose this question to the class. Yes? Yeah? What is the answer? Yes, Harshad? Yes? Very good. Yeah. So, that means, you know, if you increase the number of bits per symbol inordinately, the effect would be to increase the error behavior, error rate, right? So, for the, in that case, you would have to pump in more power. So, there is a compromise between power and symbol rate in that case, right? So, then you must be willing to pump in more power. So, there is always a tussle between resources and what you can do with the resources. I must mention, however, that in going from binary phase shift keying to quadrature phase shift keying, only from 2 to 4, the only compromise in resources is complexity. There is no compromise in bandwidth. In fact, there is a gain in bandwidth at no cost in terms of power. Right? That's something which you would be exposed to in greater detail in a course on digital communication. Yes? Well, with that then, we come to the end of both the presentations today. I thank both the groups that made the presentation, and we all thank them. On the next lecture session, we shall have a presentation by Dheeraj on the model of the human ear. So, he has a model of the human ear, and he has tried to pose it in the signals and systems framework that we have been studying in this course. I must emphasize that in all the models that you have seen, in all the presentations that you have seen, you notice again that there is a degree up to which you can use linearity or the assumptions like causality or shift invariance, and beyond that it is necessary to modify them. It is important to understand both the, you know, both the relevance or the applicability as also the limitations of the simpler concepts that we learn in a first course, right? Thank you. Now, don't run away. I'm going to take attendance. I'm going to cut off 5 marks for everybody who's absent today. Huh? Add marks for those who are present. It's an equivalent. So, today we continue our discussions of some of the best presentations that were made during the course presentation in this course. We have the fourth and the final presentation today by Dheeraj Sarvaiya. The theme of his presentation would be signal processing based on the model of a year. So he has attempted in short to model the human ear and to explain how it could be thought of as a system which carries out processing of signals. I now invite Dheeraj to put forth his ideas on the subject.
Thank you, sir, and good morning to all of you. I am Dheeraj Sarvaiya. I'm going to present my presentation on signal processing based on ear model. And the outline of my talk would be correlation of different parts of human ear with signals and systems. We will discuss on working of outer ear as a band pass filter, middle ear as an impedance matching device, inner ear in the context of Fourier transforms. As my last slide described, we can divide our ear into three parts: outer, middle and inner ear. We will discuss in great detail and later on. So let's start with psychological attributes of sound and its pitch directly related to frequency. Higher the frequency, higher the pitch. Loudness directly related to sound intensity or pressure level. Higher the decibel, higher the loudness. And this is the physical attributes, sound intensity and pressure level measured in decibel units. A decibel is a reference to the amount of sound energy. So decibel is a relative unit of sound. So 0 decibel doesn't mean absolute silence. So this is the outer ear. It enhances the energy in the vicinity of 2700 hertz, plays a minimum role in the sound transmission, amplifies high frequency sounds. It is like a convolving voice signal with some function HT having band pass around 2700 hertz. Okay. And it has, because of its special design, it assists in sound localization. And middle ear, its function as an impedance matching device. Impedance matching device we needed to transfer maximum power from energy source to a load. Okay. In general, in electrical devices, we use transformer as an impedance matching device. In ear, this is a mechanical system, so we can model it as a lever and a fulcrum. It converts large or low force displacement of air particles against the eardrum into small high force and fluid motion in cochlea. Okay. It's a very good match between the impedance of air and cochlear fluid is reached at around 1 kilohertz. It is because if we have some energy source and some resistance over here, and this is our load, energy source. So the maximum power would be transferred to this load when the load is equal to R. So because of that property, so this very good match at 1 kilohertz. So this figure shows the nozzle effect. So that means smaller the area, higher the pressure. So smaller the area, higher the pressure. So this is the